I got into writing about mathematics quite by accident. I did an article for Scientific American on hexaflexagons. That was in 1957. And as you know, Feynman was one of the great Feynman was one of the co-inventors of hexaflexagons. So it made an interesting story.
You're looking at author Martin Gardner from 1996, before he passed away in 2010. He is famous for his many books on mathematics and his regular column in Scientific American that ran from 1957 to 1981. By way of those works, he is credited with introducing topics in topology, number theory, and recreational mathematics to budding mathematicians and programmers during the computer revolution. This included John Horton Conway's Game of Life simulation. Chapter 5 of this book, published in 1952 and 1957, established Martin Gardner as a committed debunker of the UFO and flying saucer phenomenon. In the early 1980s, he was highly respected by a classmate of mine, but I had been disappointed by something he did on the 26th of January, 1978. Close Encounters of the Third Kind was showing nationwide to a blockbuster turnout, at least for Columbia Pictures. On January 26th, in the New York Review, a cantankerously skeptical Martin Gardner aggressively panned Spielberg's film, along with his companion book and the Hynek UFO Report. While you can still retrieve the full article, I'll just share a few highlights in the final outcome of Gardner's prediction. Gardner opened his piece as follows.
The film's dazzling photography, high decibel score, and tolerable acting make it hard to see how bad the film really is, but of course that is the secret of blockbusting. Alas, beneath the visual hanky-panky stretches a thin, hackneyed plot that was done to death in the science fiction magazines and third-rate films of the 1950s.
Regarding the companion book, Gardner stated that,
uncontaminated by clanking sounds and flashing colors, you can savor the film's dull story, cardboard characters, and dreary dialogue in all their pure, clean, adolescent banality. Both novel and movie, however, have one thing going for them that could make the film as whopping a success as Star Wars. More than any other science fiction novel or movie, they reflect the extent to which ufology has become a pop religion.
He continued,
for those who cannot believe in the Second Coming, or the messianic hopes of Orthodox Judaism, there are the UFOs. It is this childish possibility that has kept the flying saucers aloft for 30 years. 30 years. Exactly the age of Mr. Spielberg.
Gardner's dismissal rises to a crescendo that left a lasting impression on some of my classmates. Yet his words have since been proven false.
A few government and military officials at first took the sources seriously, but after 20 years of investigation, the Air Force finally decided that nothing extraordinary was going on overhead. To settle the matter, a distinguished physicist, Edward U. Condon, was handed $500,000 by the Air Force to produce the definitive Condon Report, a 1,000-page document that can be summarized in one sentence. There are no UFOs that cannot be explained as hoaxes, hallucinations, or honest misidentifications of such natural objects as meteors, Venus, huge balloons, conventional aircraft, re-entering satellites, and atmospheric illusions.
Gardner summed up his dismissal, telling us that
it is fashionable now to describe Spielberg as a terribly gifted but innocent prodigy, bug-eyed with wonder and lost in the Aussie worlds of modern technology and the silver screen. It will be interesting, concluded Newsweek, to watch him grow up. Yes. And the more he grows, the less likely he will make another blockbuster.
Spielberg's E.T. the Extraterrestrial achieved blockbuster status in 1983. In 1994, Spielberg won the Academy Award for Best Director for the all-too-grown-up Schindler's List, immediately following his summer blockbuster of Jurassic Park. If and when the dinosaur that is Martin Gardner is resurrected, what do you think he might say about all of this?